series, which is titled Trailblazing 100 Years of Our National Parks. So those of you who have not visited our exhibition, is in this suite of offices here, and please do so. It's a lovely exhibition, and it is our celebration of the centennial of the national parks. Our today's lecture will be on the Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad National Historic Park. The speaker is Robert Parker. He is a 15-year veteran of the National Park Service. He also serves as the superintendent of the Underground Railroad Network. Is it the Underground Railroad National Historic Park? Is that what it's called?
Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad National Historic Park and Underground Railroad Network
of
Freedom.
That's a mouthful. Okay. Prior to his assignment, he was also the superintendent of the Charles Young Buffalo Soldier National Monument Park, and that's in Wilberforce, Ohio. I happen to know about that because my former babysitter is now, for my kids, I guess, she is now his successor. We've got, just to let you guys know, before Mr. Parker comes to the podium, is that we're also going to have a lecture on the 6888 Battalion tomorrow night from 6:30 to 8. And next week and the following week, we'll also have a discussion relating to historic sites that are pertaining to African American history that are under the auspices of the National Park Service. So I do hope to see you guys here tomorrow and for the next 2 weeks. So please join me in welcoming Mr. Robert Parker.
Thank you. I appreciate the invitation to be with you for the next hour to give you more insight about what the National Park Service is currently doing to celebrate the life and legacy of Harriet Tubman. I'm certain that most of you know that Harriet Tubman's legacy, her work, and her commitment to freedom. We know that story for the most part. And what I want to do for you today is to, again, spell out how the National Park, as well as other agencies, are working in Maryland to create the new National Historic Park in her honor, and some other work that we're doing, again, to honor this iconic American hero. So, as Mr. Mitchell mentioned, this is the centennial for the National Park Service. We are excited to celebrate 100 years of stewardship and cultural and natural resource protection, education, and connecting visitors to our important stories, more important stories. We're also excited about our next century and how we're trying to create new audiences and make certain that diversity and inclusion and stories surrounding diversity and inclusion are a part of the work that we do. It's been under the administration of our current president that he has done yeoman's work in making certain that the national fabric of this history is told with diverse stories. It was under his administration that he created, through the Antiquities Act of 1906, giving him the authority, the president, the authority to create national monuments that Harriet Tubman, as well as Stonewall, as well as Pullman, and Fort Monroe, and Charles Young, as a few that he has took the time and dedication to set aside as national monuments. I think in his 8-year term, if I'm not mistaken, the last number that he's created, think it was 23 national monuments. So it's just a little over Roosevelt, who was considered for the conservation president. And so President Obama has done women's work again and establishing new national monuments. And so it was in 2013, on the 100 year anniversary of Harriet Tubman's death, which is officially Harriet Tubman Day, that presidential proclamation established the Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad National Monument. However, it was a year and a half later, in 2014, that the Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad National Historical Park was established. And so you have in Maryland the historical park as well as the national monument. In December of 2014, not only was the National Historical Park in Maryland established, but also the National Historical Park in Auburn. And so through the Defense Authorization Act created those two national parks. What people fail to understand and realize is that Harriet Tubman was born in Maryland, on the eastern shore of Maryland, about 2 hours from Washington, D.C., in a small town called Cambridge, or state Dorchester County. And so that is her birthplace. That's where she escaped. That's where she went back to several times to free her family and trusted loved ones. However, it is New York where she was involved with the suffrage movement. It was in New York where she is laid to rest. Her last known place of worship, her last home residence. So through this legislation, we have two national parks in Harriet Tubman's honor. So you have, with this, you have a national monument created in 2013, and you have a national park created through legislation or law in 2014. Excuse me, I dropped my pointer here. With the establishment of a national monument, it is required that real estate be involved, or fee simple ownership be a part of the establishment of a monument. And to that end, the Conservation Fund donated the Jacob Jackson site to the National Park Service. Jacob Jackson was a free person of color, and in 1854, he received a coded letter written for Harriet Tubman, sent by Harriet Tubman, to have him alert her brothers that she was returning to Cambridge, Maryland, or what was called Madison, to rescue her brothers. Again, Harriet's motivation as a part of the Underground Railroad was to not only free herself, but to free her family members. And so what we have on record at this point is that Harriet Tubman returned to Cambridge, Maryland, or I should say the Eastern Shore of Maryland, because there were several locations that her activities took place. But she returned, broadly speaking, to Cambridge, Maryland, Eastern Shore, for 13 times, and she rescued about 60 to 70 people. We have that documentation. And that documentation is what you're going to present in our exhibits and as a part of our interpretive experience when you come to visit us. And so, to that end, Jacob Jackson's site is significant because he was a conduit to Harriet Tubman's activities in terms of the Underground Railroad, and basically, again, alerting her brothers that she was returning to rescue them. And so Jacob Jackson is about 480 acres, and that's what the National Park Service owns in fee simple. So I'm going to confuse you for a bit, and I hope you can see this boundary map, so we can kind of spell out for you what you're going to experience when you come to the Eastern Shore of Maryland. Because I do believe, and I do trust, that you're all going to be in Maryland next year when we open the park in 2017, am I correct? Okay, you're too close now to come and visit this for yourself. So let me sort of help you understand the lay of the land. The National Monument is approximately 25,500 acres. The monument is in designation, a federal designation in name alone. It does not mean that the National Park Service or the state or the county has any regulatory jurisdiction over the monument. Now, what you have with the monument, this green outlay here, can you follow me? This green boundary line here is all of the monument. And again, these 25,500 acres is a corridor of landscapes, marshes, waterways, and trails, and undeveloped view sheds, if you will, that pretty much looks like what Harriet Tubman would have seen while in Cambridge, Maryland on the Eastern Shore. Again, she was born there around about 1820-ish, and she left this area in 1849. And so the national park within this monument is this green hashed boxed area here. That's your 480 acres, which is Jacob Jackson. Here, where you see the sign that speaks to the state park, there's also a state park within the national monument that was created by, of course, state officials of Maryland. Maryland State Park Service is the National Park Service's official partner through legislation and proclamation. So I have a mandate by Congress and the President to work with this agency. And we have a common goal to, again, connect you, the visitor, to Harriet Tubman's significance and to her legacy, particularly in Maryland. Also within this monument, you have about 11,750 acres of property that belongs to U.S. Fish and Wildlife. U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service has a majority of the property, federal property, that also helps us to protect the cultural landscape. Again, because Harriet was a slave when she left the Eastern Shore, and a lot of those artifacts, a lot of those historical structures that were associated to her life and legacy at that time while she was there is no longer in existence. But what we're doing is connecting you to the landscape that was necessary for her to make these successful escapes and rescues. Again, she had to navigate through these wooded areas. She had to understand the marshes, and she had to understand trails and roads and those types of things to be successful as a part of the Underground Railroad. So we're protecting the landscape. That's why the National Monument is important. But within that National Monument, you have a National Historical Park, which is Jacob Jackson, the 480 acres I mentioned. But you also have a state park, which is 17 acres. And then you have Fish and Wildlife, Blackwater Wildlife Refuge, which is about 11,750 acres. So you have several federal and state agencies that are protecting Harriet Tubman's legacy throughout this vast landscape of about 25,500 acres. But then you also have other places that are associated to Harriet Tubman's life, such as the Bucktown School. Sorry. I'm giving it away. Okay. The Bucktown Store is right there to the far left, my far left, your right. And that particular historic structure is one of the few remaining structures that, of course, we do not own. It's privately owned by our foundation. But it was at that store where Harriet really begins to capture these moments that she associates to her work with the Underground Railroad. It was at this store that an overseer was trying to stop a young slave boy. And Harriet was asked, or Minty as he would call her, she was called, her name was Arietta Ross, nicknamed Minty. And she later changed her name to Harriet Tubman. But nonetheless, Harriet was asked to stop this young slave boy from running away. And even then, as a young child, she refused. And so the overseer threw a 2-pound weight and hit her in the head. And it was from that injury that she began to fall into these deep sleeps. And from those moments that she would fall asleep, she had these visions, she would say, by God, that inspired her to do what she was going to do, which was later become this. Stop here for a moment and ask the question of the audience. What do you know about the railroad in terms of Harriet Tubman? What were you taught as a young child? Was it that Harriet Tubman is the founder of the Underground Railroad? Is that what you made?
Yes.
Unfortunately, that's not true. She is not the founder of the Underground Railroad. The Underground Railroad is a network of organizations. It was a network of people, safe houses. It was this clandestine way of keeping a secret for the most part. And this network existed prior to Harriet Tubman's own escape. She self-emancipated by running away. And it was through her own escape that she discovered that there were individuals and organizations that were fighting for this whole idea of secretly helping slaves escape to their freedom or escape slavery. I will say that you're already free, you're born free, but these individuals unfortunately were in slavery. So again, the Underground Railroad was about helping people escape the institution of slavery. But nonetheless, that is a misnomer that Harriet Tubman is the founder. She is what we would refer to as probably the most famous or most noted conductor, but not the only person. It wasn't an individual idea or a single notion. It was networks of philanthropy, and it was, of course, the Quaker organization. It was a lot of moving parts. And so Harriet began to work with this network once she received her own freedom. But the interesting piece is that she went back into slavery, particularly after the Fugitive Slave Law of 1850. And it was this law that pretty much would add harsh repercussions to not only the slave that had escaped, but anyone who would assist a slave through escaping. And you have these young white men who were trying to join this whole idea of being slave catchers, because it was a pretty penny in retrieving a slave and returning that slave back to slavery. And so, you know, you have a lot of slave catchers out there. So she risked her life, what we've documented, for 13 times coming back to Cambridge and Maryland. And so, that speaks volumes, and that is really one of the reasons why she rises to national significance through those trips. But again, you have a monument, you have a National Historical Park, you have places like Boat Charles Thorpe, Scott's Chapel, where she might have worshipped. You have all these places within this vast corridor of landscape that has been pretty much undeveloped over the years. And so we're there now, the National Park is there now, in support of this mission to protect, preserve, and connect you to her legacy. And this is the space and place where you're going to find those experiences. We hope that once you come to Maryland and you visit the Visitor Center, which will be this sort of gateway to her story, that you will go out and travel. There is a byway. There's the Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad byway that stretches about 125 miles. Throughout this area up to Delaware, that you can experience those places associated to Harriet Tubman or the Underground Railroad. And so, I kind of gave you guys an edge when I let you see my slide, but this cannot be done alone. The National Park Service is really moving away from operating in a vacuum or doing work independently. And so it takes the partnership of, as I mentioned to you before, Maryland Department of Natural Resources, Maryland Park Service, as well as the Bucktown School. That foundation has been working with us to, again, help us bring visitors to that location to share that story in particular. The Fish and Wildlife Refuge, Harriet Tubman Byway, Tourism, Maryland Office of Tourism. There's so many partnerships that really help us do what we do in making this vision come to fruition. And so, as it was mentioned earlier, we are mandated by legislation to partner with the state of Maryland. So Maryland Park Service, working along with Maryland Office of Tourism, not only created a national two-year state park, but they received funding from a transportation grant to build a 15,000 square foot visitor center that consists of exhibit space, of course, a museum store, a pavilion, a 2,600 square foot open air pavilion with fireplace, a stone fireplace, as well as a legacy garden and administrative building. So it is a very unique concept called the View North. And of course, when you come to the state park, you will find a national park there too. Now, although Jacob Jackson is a part of the state that I mentioned, and that's what the National Park Service owns, our office administration functions are based out of the state park. And so through the legislation, the National Park and State Park will co-manage a visitor center. And we have been working with them since 2013 to make that happen. And we're hopeful that March 10th, well, I would say we're hopeful, we're determined that on March 10th, 2017, we will have our grand opening of this facility. And so you will not see a statue. Again, the monument is not that. When you think of monument, you typically think of something tangible, something that you can touch or see in that regard. But again, the monument is the landscape. But what you will see is this visitor center that's going to give you this unique story of resistance, this story of this relentless fortitude to be free and to escape the institution of slavery. You're going to connect to those types of interpretive things. So meanwhile, what we're doing is trying to connect the public and the community to what we can offer, although we're not available, although your visitor experience is not available on site at the moment. So we do have interpretive materials and programming that we try to do. Last year we had a special event on Harriet Tubman Day 2016, this past year, as well as 2015. We did these activities to again engage you, give you a progress report as to where we're going with planning of this exhibit. And when we were hopeful to open the visitor center this year, but unfortunately the exhibits were not ready in terms of fabrication and installation. But we are in a better place this year for next year. So we feel 10 times more confident that we'll be open in 2017. Again, I'll give you a couple of examples of what we offer. Our cooperative agreements with partners, i.e. Fish and Wildlife, State of Maryland, Howard University, University of Maryland, I'm sure. There's so many, and again, these agencies, these entities are really helping us do the type of work that we hope is satisfactory to the community and honorable to Harriet Tubman's legacy. Also housed in this new visitor center is the new headquarters for the Underground Railroad Network to Freedom Program, which was founded in 1998 through legislation approved by Congress, of course. And this national program, we should liken it to the National Register of Historic Places or the National Historic Landmark Program. It is a network of historical places, facilities, or specialized programs that have a verifiable or active story related to the Underground Railroad. So it's this program that separates Harriet Tubman from the Underground Railroad, because this is a national program. It's not just about Harriet Tubman. And it shows those distinctions, because in this country, there are so many undocumented, less known stories about Underground Railroad. And it was through Congress that authorized the National Park Service to do a study of the vast geographical areas and places associated to the Underground Railroad. And so, because it was determined there were so many stories in this country that instead of having every story or site become a national park, we created this network. And so each year we have two rounds of nominations whereby places that have a story or have an association to the Underground Railroad could possibly become members. And the benefits of this national program is, one, you get technical support and grants or financial support from the National Park Service to help that agency, to help that state or that county organization maintain maybe a house that is associated to the Underground Railroad, or maybe an archive that has a special collection or special papers about the Underground Railroad. Again, we provide that type of technical and financial support to the National Underground Railroad Network to Freedom Program. And this program now falls under my purview and responsibility for my portfolio. Before, this national program was based out of Ohio, out of our Midwest regional office. But since that time, it's been relocated to Maryland and now placed in a park, and our regional office is actually in a park. And one of the reasons we think that's befitting, because the Underground Railroad Network to Freedom Program is a grassroots program. And so we're really in the community, and we're really engaging those lesser known stories about the Underground. Each year we have a national conference that explores new scholarship connected to the Underground Railroad. Just this past year we had our conference in Hilton Head, South Carolina. There's a special free community, one of the first free communities, self-sufficient black communities that was organized right after the Civil War, called Neutralville. And so we'd like to have our national conferences where there are Network to Freedom members that can help us connect new visitors, new audiences to these interesting and important stories. This year, because of our grand opening of the Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad Underground Railroad Visitor Center, we're going to have this national conference in Cambridge or the Eastern Shore. So more to come on that as well. We're actually trying to do some strategic planning with this program. Now that it's aligned with the park and not our region, again, we want to do more grassroots activities. So when national parks are created, unfortunately, it's not a turnkey situation. I think the thinking of the community and certain individuals is that once a place is established, you can go visit the next day, or you can go visit subsequently a few months later. But in this case, that's not been our experience. Because we've had this planning with the visitor center, there's been planning with, how we want to connect people to this story. And so a couple of things have to happen. The first thing that took place was in 2008, when Congress authorized a national park to do a special resource study to determine the why. Why is Harriet Tubman's story important? And we all know why that story is important and why it's national. But from that special resource study, it was determined that two national parks should be created. One in Maryland, where she was born, where she escaped from, where she went back to 13 times to rescue her family and trusted loved ones, and New York, where she was buried, where her last residence is, where the home of for the aged is, where she worshiped. And so that particular study or that plan was then given to Congress as a recommendation to create these new national parks. And again, there was some movement, but it wasn't until 2013 that the national monument was created. Although the legislation for both national parks was underway, it did not advance. And so luckily, we were able to get the monument created in the meanwhile. The next document and special project that we're working on is the foundation document, which is in progress, and that's the why. What is here that's so important? What significance should we make certain that you, the visitor, connect to? And it also speaks to the interpretive things. Again, she escaped from slavery, so we talk and think in terms of interpretive things around freedom. And so those types of things are touched upon, but not really discussed. There are a few other progress studies that are in place, and they're underway for 17, fiscal year 17 and 16. But the next big plan, here's our general management plan, and that will really be the plan that's going to kick off a lot of what we do, and that is the how. How do we go about preserving these resources? How do we make certain that you, the visitor, have an awesome experience? And what information do we provide to you? So those are things that are going to happen in the future. Typically, when I do this presentation, it's with the state of Maryland. It's with the Maryland Park Manager. But unfortunately, she's not able to be here, so I'm going to move forward and connect you to the state piece of this partnership. And so what you have before you is the site plan and what it is that you can experience when you come. So you will enter on the south side of the visitor center. And of course, we have four gardens here, which is sort of set up like stations, if you will, on the Underground Railroad. It is very linear, but yet not totally adjacent to each other. It's really interesting how that is configured. You have the exhibit area, again, these four pitch roof area, the administration building, as well as the pavilion. And then the legacy garden, which will be these meandering walkways. Again, everything on the north, excuse me, south to north passage, giving this whole idea of the view north. Again, it is about a person who's been enslaved, journeying towards freedom and equality in a north direction. So once you come in the visitor center, you're gonna start from the north, excuse me, from the south, and make your way north. Again, that's another layout of what you will experience in floor plan. These are aerial views, excuse me, not aerial views, but these are views upon arrival, what you see in the artist's and architect's renderings, additional renderings. But this is the pre-construction. This is sort of earlier, this probably was taken about a year or so ago. And this is from Route 335. What I love about this building is the exposed beams, the exposed wooden beams. Harriet Tubman's father was a trusted timber foreman in the area, and so this symbolizes his work as a timber foreman. And Harriet Tubman worked alongside her father. So again, knowing those natural places in that landscape and knowing how to navigate and traverse through those areas that we're now protecting. And so you'll see these exposed beams when you come into the visitor center. Again, this is an aerial view of what you'll see and the exhibits as they are designed and laid out here. We're here at this point. The construction is complete. You see that there are, again, these four volumes. And the first volume is the more modern volume, the more modern space where there is your visitor orientation theater, it's the bathroom, it's the museum store, It's our library, our multi-purpose, very modern amenities that you experience here and where you get your initial orientation. The last three volumes is the historical story that you're going to be connected to. That's that experience that you want to be immersed. And it's very evocative, this whole idea of connecting to Harriet Tubman's life. Again, this more photos aside. This is an aerial, too. Not, I love that word today for some reason. But this is another view of the visitor center from the gardens, from the memorial gardens. This is a green certified. So what you see here is from the roof. We have vegetated roofs. This is a silver leaf building. There are solar panel lights, as well as a number of other green technologies. That's too technical, I don't want to bore you with that, but we are a LEED certified building. So this again is the 26 square foot pavilion, open air pavilion, that will be available for room use through a special use permit. So if you have a family reunion or there's a special organization where you may want to come out and have your tour and at the same time use this space, that will be available to the public as well for a small cost recovery. Again, this is just a side view of what you're going to see. Again, the exhibits are in the historical experiences on the last three volumes, while the modern amenities are in the initial volume as you enter the building. And this is the layout of the exhibits. And again, we tried to, in meeting with the team, there was a team of folks that worked on the exhibit design process for this exhibit, and we determined that Harriet Tubman was shaped by her experiences in the Choptank River region area, and that the most important things were faith, family, and community. And so we try to bring those things out in your experience as well through those exhibits. I think this virtual tour is going to help you. I don't know that I can get this file at this point. Unfortunately, I cannot do that. Nonetheless, I welcome you to join us on March 10th, 2017 for our grand opening. Are there any questions? The grand opening will be on site. The park is located at 4068 Golden Hill Road, and that's Church Creek, Maryland. Church Creek, Maryland. Yes, ma'am. Repeat the question, please.
Sure. Will this be the largest national historic site in the country?
No, it will not be.
Oh, okay.
I wish it were, but no, ma'am. It is the largest state park, and for the state, this is their biggest investment. This was a $21 million project.
Robert, I have a historical question. I think you mentioned the documented number of people who were free. It was approximately 60, 70, would you say?
That we have documented through substantiated records. That's not to suggest that there were more, because she also guided a lot of rescues. And what I mean by that, she gave advice in terms of who to talk to, where to go, and how to make it work. So we're not including those numbers, only because those weren't rescues. We're talking about who Harriet Tubman actually escorted out of slavery versus who she assisted and provided some support and guidance to. And that doesn't also, does not count for the Combahee River raids that took place in South Carolina during her work in the Civil War, which was about 700 or so slaves that she helped free in another way. Again, it's not rescues. And let's be clear, Harriet Tubman never went down to the Deep South to rescue slaves or to escort slaves to the North. The farthest that Harriet Tubman went to rescue slaves was her hometown. And she was going, it drew motivation to rescue her family members and trusted friends. So I think there's a lot of misnomers that she was in Mississippi and North Carolina, all those places, and that's not true.
Now, how far did she go in terms of once she was able to bring her family and other friends out of slavery? How far did she go in terms of arriving? Did she, and I think you sort of alluded to that earlier, but I was trying to get clarity on exactly where did she go?
Wow. The farthest would be Canada. And at one point, she ended up living in Canada for a small period of time. And then, of course, I guess, I don't want to say retiring, if you will, but settling in New York.
And my last question is, as you were aware of this, Frederick Douglass went to England.
Went to where?
When he went to England, as a result of John Brown raid, he basically had to leave the country because it was pretty hot for him here. He received his freedom as a result of money that was collected by the British. Where he actually, because he was basically during the height of his career, he was basically a fugitive slave, as with Harriet Tubman. Now, was there ever any attempt to raise money to free her, or basically she was freed by the 13th Amendment? In this case, since Maryland was in the Union, obviously they weren't impacted by the Emancipation Proclamation. So was there ever any attempt to raise funds to free her?
From the research that I've read, no.
So she was basically a fugitive slave until the passage of the 13th Amendment.
I understand, yes.
Or the passage where the slave was free in Maryland.
Right. Yes. Frederick Douglass' birthplace is in Talbot County, which is also a part of the National Historical Park. Well, potential for National Historical Park. But her birthplace was in Dorchester, his was in Talbot, so a county away. Let me go back to the slide to kind of help put that in perspective a little bit more. And I failed to mention that. These red hashed areas here, those areas are privately owned, but those areas are also what we consider our acquisition boundary area, which means that Congress has only given the National Park Service authority to purchase those properties in this red hashed area. So we can't go throughout the monument. Say, for instance, this white space here, which is a private in-holding. We can't go in this area and try to acquire that again because Congress has not given us permission to do so. And so if we have a willing seller or donor, the red hashed area could be part of the National Historical Park. So my 480 acres that the National Park Service has responsibility for could increase to 2,000 acres based on who the willing seller or donor could be. We cannot condemn land, nor can we operate through the eminent domain. And that's in our Constitution. That's in our legislation.
Any other questions?
Yes.
Would you be willing to speculate at all about what it is about the Eastern Shore that was producing these leaders?
Wow. That's a great question. I don't think I've ever thought about it, but I do believe that possibly, maybe it is because Well, it's a great question. It could be serendipitous, but I think that maybe because the way slavery was, the way it functioned in the Eastern Shore, it was easy for you to be hired out from your plantation, and having to walk from one location to another and having the opportunity of being away from one place to, from one plantation to another workplace, and your presence being there for a while, it goes unnoticed. Because Harriet Tubman attempted to run away prior to 1840s, but she came back. But it wasn't noticed because she was hired out by another farmer's opinion. And so I think that makes it easy to a degree, because you have sort of this liberty and this autonomy to kind of go and come and to hire yourself out, which is what she did. So that might make those escapes easier. But again, in terms of Frederick Douglass and Harriet Tubman being the Eastern Shore and became great leaders with the Underground Railroad or the abolitionist movement, it might just be serendipitous, I think.
Any other questions?
Yes, we do. There is a whole section that speaks to that. At least I can find that for you in that layout here. So although the construction is complete, we're going to go back to being a construction site once the installation of the exhibits are being installed. So, I believe it's right here. This entire section speaks to her work with the Civil War and the Combahee River Raid there. Of course, we look at other Network to Freedom, Underground Railroad stories. We look at her own liberation here, her at work family, the slave community. It's a very immersive, emotive type of experience. We actually want you to go on your own journey, if you will, and we create this space here that gives you the feel that you're in this night sky, and you have to, and there's a soundscape that gives you the feeling of what it might have been like on the journey by yourself at night. So yeah, we try to create these different connections to help you really get a chance to feel what it might have been like to run away to your freedom. Any other questions?
Okay, well, this concludes the presentation, and Robert, I'd like to thank you for this very informative